Well, please welcome to the show Derwin Gray, pastor of Transformation Church and author of a wonderful book. It's just out, The High Definition Leader. And Derwin, thank you for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm honored to be here. I've watched the show, and it's kind of surreal to actually be here. So I'm excited about it. Thank you.
You're going to stay in the moment. All right. Let's kick it off with something Martin Luther King Jr. said, that Sunday morning is the most segregated hour in America. Is that still true?
In 2015, that is still true. That Dr. King's words echo throughout history, that that's still true. But I would even add that the King of Kings, before Dr. King said those words, the King of Kings, Jesus himself, has always desired for his people, Jew and Gentile, or to use a more a common term, is people of different ethnicities, to be in him together, not in sameness, not in uniformity, mm-hmm. but the beauty of diversity, that the blood of Jesus is now what defines us, and not the color of our skin, but the color of his blood that makes us a new redeemed people, where we don't stop being who God's created us to be, but we become a better version of us. And that diversity adds to the beauty mm-hmm. of the church, to the beauty of who Christ is for a lost world that doesn't know nothing of love and unity.
And it also takes advantage of all the wonderful giftings
That's right.
God has given. When you look at the first church meeting, it's Pentecost.
That's right.
And you have all different kinds of languages, all different kinds of races.
That's right.
And they're all hearing the same message, and they're all joining in, and it's a wonderful picture. Then you turn to Revelation, and you say, well, this is going to happen again. Why have we lost sight of it? Why do we not try to achieve that, or even realize that it's an ideal to be achieved?
Yeah, so I would say the first thing is that as Western Christians out of the Reformation, we've made the gospel just soteriological, meaning that Jesus died and rose again so I can be saved. That's true. But individual salvation only exists so God the Father can have a family. And so the cross is a vertical beam and a horizontal beam. The vertical beam reconciles us with God. The horizontal beam reconciles humanity that are enemies who now become brothers and sisters in Christ. And so for the early church, the word ecclesia, the called out ones, mm-hmm. to the Apostle Paul and to the early apostles, by definition, meant multi-ethnic church, because it was Jews and Gentiles. And Paul's theology in his letters was the working out of how there could be unity and diversity when Christ is the glue that holds this vision together. So I think in the West, we've forgotten the horizontal beam. And so therefore we can say things like, well, black church or white church, or let's make churches based on our preferences, when in reality, we need to put down our preferences and pick up our crosses, because a local church isn't about my comfort. It's about the development of my character for the glory of God. And that happens in the context of diversity. And it blew the Roman world away. Mm-hmm. N.T. Wright, a scholar from England, said that the Apostle Paul was able to do what he could never do. The emperor wanted to bring the various factions and ethnicities together, but only the Apostle Paul and his house churches could do that. Why? Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel is a much more beautiful, richer story than Jesus bled and died so I could go to heaven. He bled, he died, he redeemed us to form a new humanity that's now influenced, not by the color of their skin, but by the color of his blood, and where his agenda becomes preeminent.
And it even it crosses the gender gap.
It does.
You know, we're all one in Christ.
That's right.
And in that unity, when we have that one purpose, one accord, one mind, that unity, real miracles happen.
It does.
I mean, you do see transformation that is incredible.
And that'd be a great name for a church, too, Transformation Church.
It would.
And hence, that's why our name is Transformation Church, because we believe that the gospel fundamentally transforms us through the indwelling life of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit to bring about that unity. And when the Apostle Paul said the words in Galatians 3:28, which was his first book, there's neither Jew nor Greek. In other words, being a Jew or a Greek is not better than the other. In Christ, we're equal and redeemed. Bring the best of you, and I'll bring the best of me. There's neither free nor slave. In other words, the CEO and the garbage man gets treated the same way. There's neither male nor female. Jesus liberated women with equality. A first century context, whether if it was Jewish or Roman, women were cattle. Yeah. And Jesus is like, no. Women are image bearers for the glory of God, as gifted as men are. And that's a picture of what the kingdom looks like. Neither Jew nor Greek, free nor slave, male nor female, because we're all one in Christ.
You did it intentionally. You went after this as an ideal, and you've succeeded. You have a church that crosses all of these lines. How, so for somebody watching right now, how did you do it, and how can they do it?
Well, the first thing is, I'm one person among many servant leaders. So I have an important role to play, but I know to surround myself with people that are more gifted and smarter, i.e. my wife, first and foremost. I'm Scottie Pippen, she's Michael Jordan. All so, right. So the first thing was, we as a community bought into the gospel vision that this was God's heartbeat. And then secondly, our leadership team was diverse, not just in ethnicity, but in age. My executive pastor is a 61-year-old white man. Mm-hmm. And so he preaches as well. And that's to make a statement. So our leadership team was ethnically diverse, generationally diverse. And then our worship music is cross-cultural as well. And then we simply want to preach the Bible. My doctoral work is in first century, second temple Jewish understanding of the faith and how radical it was for Paul to say, I'm going to the Gentiles. And The Pharisees said, this man shouldn't live. And so that was a gospel bomb in a fractured, segregated world. And what does the devil love? He can't touch Jesus. Jesus already won. But if he can get Jesus's people to be divided, he can limit the effectiveness of the church. And so what we're proposing isn't something new. It's something that's always been true in God's heartbeat. And we need this renaissance for the church in America to display the glory of God and say to a world that is increasingly pushing back from Christ, this is what love and reconciliation looks like. Like, this is the hill. You know, most folks say this is the hill they want to die on. This is the hill I want to live on and for the church in America and the world to live on.
Is this the answer to what we're seeing now in our culture? You know, you it's almost like we're having a throwback, if you will, to the 1960s. Yeah. And we're getting really, really dramatic pictures that we're still divided. We're still multi-cultures that have and cultures that don't. How do we get through that? And how do we have a true unity? We say a lot, one nation under God, indivisible. Mm-hmm. But we're clearly divisible. Yeah. How do we reconcile as a people, as a nation?
Yeah, so my theology informs me that the church is to be salt, and salt preserves and gives taste. Well, if the church itself is a homogeneous, fractured church, I mean, just look at the way black Christians vote and white Christians vote. Look at the way white Christians see the Michael Brown incident and black Christians see the Michael Brown incident, not to mention Latino and Asian as well. So if we as the church aren't unified, the world has no hope. So our unification along ethnic and socioeconomic lines is so important as a preservative to the culture, to teach the culture what love is. So a lot of this unrest, I put at the feet of the church to go, this happened on our watch. Mm-hmm. This is on our watch. We were so busy building buildings and Disneyland for Jesus. And I mean, we're so busy doing those things that we, on our watch, have allowed this to happen. So as a local church pastor, I'm calling for a new type of reformation founded in the gospel, that this Jesus unifies folks. He doesn't just send them to heaven when they die. He brings a foretaste of heaven to earth now in and through us. And that we can be a window that a world looks through, like kids at a candy store, to go, can I get in there and have some of that? Yeah. That looks good. Taste and see that the Lord is good. And right now people are going, boy, the church, that's a kind of bland taste. Where's the diversity of taste? Mm. And we can be that in the gospel.
And we can. And we can have, we're actually supposed to pray that his will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. So if we're seeing it in heaven, we need to be seeing it here in earth. Well, the book, it's called The High Definition Leader. It's available wherever books are sold. And Derwin, thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Yeah.
God bless you.